The four of us come from nothing. And, you know, we hatched this little dream between us and fought all odds and succeeded. I kind of formed this mythological idea of this band called the Smashing Pumpkins. It seemed very obvious to me that if someone could somehow combine everything that they liked about music into like almost like a hodgepodge band, that seemed obvious to me where I wanted to go. So I just picked like my seven favorite bands.
Drawing on influences from bands the likes of Black Sabbath to Bauhaus and Bowie, Corgan found his musical ideal, but what he couldn't find were bandmates.
I tried to find people and it just didn't happen that way. It was more like accidental meetings kind of thing. I didn't know anybody really before the band was formed.
It was just me and Billy and a drum machine, and we demoed, played songs for I don't know how long, 6 months. And then we did a show in this local Polish bar with him on bass, me on guitar, and a drum machine.
Hi, we're the Smashing Pumpkins and you're watching The Week in...
Well, don't interrupt!
It was Billy who interrupted Darcy when they met outside a Chicago nightclub.
I met Darcy in an argument on the street. We started arguing about the Dan Reed Network.
He was saying, you can tell this band is put together by a record company because look at the way that guy jumps around on stage. Regular people in bands don't jump around on stage like that. And I was like, well, I don't know. I play guitar and I kind of move around on stage a little bit. He's like, oh yeah? Well, I'm looking for a bass player. It's like, here's my number.
Went to see the Pumpkins a couple times when they played with a drum machine. And it was just horrendous. They were horrible. But the songs were really good. I thought Billy was a really good songwriter, and I wanted to work with him. So we just kind of clicked. We never really looked back. We just kind of went for it.
The band finally a reality, all that remained was a name.
The name was a joke. I was telling a joke to somebody and I thought, oh, that'd be a funny band name, and it just stuck. I couldn't shake it.
The name was always there. There was nothing I could do about it. I never made friends with the name.
It's a name that sort of sounds like Echo and the Bunnymen. And Echo and the Bunnymen, it's like the dumbest name on earth, but you get a couple of their albums and you're like, yeah, Echo and the Bunnymen, they're rocking.
Please welcome Smashing Pumpkins! The Pumpkins were anything but welcome in their hometown of Chicago. With their style of music never quite meshed with the city's popular house, industrial, and indie punk scene.
For anybody who knows anything about Chicago, I mean, you have kind of the Wax Trax, you know, ministry kind of thing. And then the other side, you have touch and go kind of scene.
We weren't with any of those scenes. We weren't cool like the touch and go bands.
It was very much this kind of flannel driven, no guitar solos, 3 minute pop songs. And we were playing these like 6 minute songs with guitar solos, and we were doing all the wrong things. I think if we had been accepted into the local Chicago music scene community right away, I think we probably would have ended up being a different band. But being outcasts or feeling somewhat outside of the inner core of Chicago music pushed us further away, I think. The album's about pain and spiritual ascension, and people ask if it's a political album. It's not a political album, it's just a personal album. In a weird way, Gish is almost like an instrumental album. You know, it just happens to have singing on it. But the music overpowers the singing in a lot of places. I was trying to say a lot of things that I couldn't really say in kind of intangible, unspeakable ways. So I was capable of doing that with the music. I don't think I was as capable of doing that with words.
first record, I think, was done really quickly. We weren't, and Billy wasn't as experienced in the studio.
I'd never been in that situation, but it was like I knew what I was doing. I knew what I needed to do. I think on a personal level, I probably lost my mind and had a nervous breakdown.
I could never do it over again, and I don't know how we survived it, but I've really, really loved that album so much.
Gish was released in the spring of 1991, but the record was eclipsed by the music of another band, sending the Pumpkins on a musical skid.
We released our album, you know, roughly 2 to 3 months before Nevermind came out. Nevermind came out, that's obvious, that changed the way music will be for a long time. The residue of that was very, very strong. It really affected the way everyone was thinking, from media to record company to our own management. Here we were, a band that was very versed in playing 5-minute elaborate rock songs, and everyone's going, why don't you play 3-minute pop songs? And you're going, because we don't? That's what really started me on this kind of crazy spin, because I spent years formulating this mythical idea of a band and Gish, and it came to a head, and then suddenly it was like, where do you start over?
With Billy enveloped in a deep musical quandary, James and Darcy ending a rocky relationship, and Jimmy struggling with drugs, the Pumpkins were completely disjointed going into their follow-up record.
During Siamese Dream was probably the most volatile period we've ever gone through. There was a lot of tension in the band, and to be quite honest, I didn't think we'd make another record after that.
For lack of a better term, I went through some kind of weird musical suicide, where it was either continue to try and posture as something that I wasn't, or just be myself, which is a sappy, corny rock boy, you know, who likes to write love songs and likes to write rock songs, and, you know, just do it, don't worry about it. Suddenly, I felt emotions come back that I hadn't felt for months, and Today was one of the songs that I wrote.
With other successful singles like Disarm, Cherub Rock, and Rocket, Siamese Dream sold over 3 million copies, far exceeding Corrigan's comprehension.
It's like really impossible to conceive that 1 million or 2 million or 3 million people went to a record store, picked up your album, looked at it, and went, okay, I'll get this. This looks like a good thing. That's pretty inconceivable.
Even more inconceivable was that the band managed to stay together through it all.
The fact that the album came out of it is the one thing, but we learned to like each other again. We reconnected our friendships and found why we were together in the first place, and realized that it was all these external things that had driven us apart. And suddenly we found out that there was still a strength, and maybe it had been obscured, but it felt real again.
We're coming to your city.
If it's a terrible dive and it's a bunch of bad people hanging out, well, I'm sure we'll be there.
Das Live-Konzert, und zwar von einer der erfolgreichsten jungen amerikanischen Bands aus Chicago. Hier sind Smashing Pumpkins!
With Siamese Dream already a hit and a B-sides album soon to be released, the Pumpkins hit the road on a lengthy tour.
I think the basic opinion in the band is love playing live, hate the tour.
It's so exhilarating and demoralizing and ego building and ego tearing down all at the same time.
When you're on tour and you're constantly having to provide a product for people to ingest, it jades you. Sometimes the music can be the enemy, you know, you're like, and that's not the way it should be.
Everybody's sort of romanticized.